Let's begin with the topic. As you all know, today's enlightening topic is urticaria, that is Sheeta Pitta. In current scenario of changing life pattern, sedentary lifestyle, negligence in following rules of healthy living, faulty eating habits, polluted environment, workload, too much of stress, all this has become a potential trigger for manifestations of various skin disorders. And Sheeta Pitta is one of amongst it. So let's begin the etymology of the let's begin with the etymology of the word urticaria. So the word urticaria has been derived from a Latin word urtica, which means nettle. Urtica itself, it is related to the Latin verb uriri, means to burn. So urticaria that way is a term which is defined as, or which we can call it as a nettle rash or a rash which has got burning sensation. Commonly the urticaria is referred with a synonym as hives. Even nettle rash is also one of its synonym. So hives or the urticaria is a kind of skin rash which is notable for pale red color, raised patches and itchy bumps. So when we say the basics of urticaria, it is a vascular reaction of the skin, and generally it is characterized by the veils. So what are veils? Veils are a central swelling surrounded by the erythema. Itching or burning sensation is always present in these veils, and generally or usually these veils disappear within 1 to 24 hours. Then cardinal symptom of urticaria is nothing but the itch or the pruritus, and urticaria is caused by the swelling of the upper dermis. And when we deal with the prevalence, it is said that urticaria is a common condition with lifetime incidence of approximately 15%. It is said that any person in his lifetime can suffer from urticaria, and the chances of suffering from urticaria is approximately 15%. And the data reveals that the incidence of urticaria is more in females as compared to males, and the peak age of onset is in adults, and the age is between 20 to 40 years. Maybe the stress is the one of the reason for this typical incidence during these years of age. Then, as we know, urticaria is broadly categorized into acute and chronic. If it lasts more than 6 weeks, then it is called as chronic urticaria. And if it lasts less than 6 weeks, then it is acute urticaria. The incidence of chronic urticaria is 1% of the acute. That means acute urticaria is more common than the chronic urticaria. And when we say the etiopathology or the etiology for the disease, 50% of the urticaria, we cannot isolate or we cannot identify the cause of the urticaria, and then we have to label that as a chronic idiopathic urticaria. So again, these are the classifications. Urticaria broadly can be categorized into spontaneous urticaria, physical urticaria, and the other types. Spontaneous is again subcategorized into acute and chronic. Acute if it is less than 6 weeks, chronic if it is more than 6 weeks. Then the physical urticaria, they are again subgrouped into cold contact, delayed pressure, heat contact, solar, dermographic, vibratory. And then the other causes includes, or the other categories includes, aquagenic, cholinergic, contact, exercise induced, and anaphylaxis urticaria. So these are just mere the subgroup depending upon the causative or the eliciting factors. That means if it is triggered by the cold air, cold water, cold wind, then it is cold contact. If it is due to vertical pressure, then it is pressure urticaria. If it is due to heat, then it is heat contacts. That way it is just a sub categorization of the urticaria. So these are the allergic triggers. Acute urticaria, mainly it is drug induced, and drug includes beta lactam antibiotics, sulfonamides, and we can say that vulnerable drug to cause the urticaria is aspirin. It generally leads to urticaria along with angioedema. What is angioedema? We will see it later. So when we are discussing the allergic triggers, first comes the drugs, then comes the foods: milk, egg, peanut, sesame seeds, soya, wheat, shellfish, and the fish. These are the common contributing factors or the allergic triggers. Food additives also one of the allergic triggers. Then the infections, insect bite and stings, then contactants and inhalants are also one of the allergic triggers. Then the chronic urticaria, we have seen the physical factors, and when we cannot find any trigger, then we can label it as a idiopathic. When we say the infections which can trigger urticaria includes viral infections, bacterial infections, parasitic and fungal. Viral, it is hepatitis, upper respiratory infections, it can be herpes or it can be Coxsackie A and B. Bacterial, generally it is associated with the infections of the upper respiratory tract, that is pharyngitis, tonsillitis, otitis media. Sometimes UTI also can trigger urticaria. The parasitic infections include ascaris, then schistosoma, and the filaria also can lead to urticaria. Fungal, it is still a question mark whether candida can trigger the urticaria, but still it is in the list. Then, as I've said, the hives are either acute or chronic. Acute is lasting less than 6 weeks, and they are more common in children and adults. Then the chronic, if it is more than 6 weeks and recurrence is frequent, and the disease, if it is persisting over months or years, then we can label it as a chronic urticaria. The peak prevalence is the middle-aged population, and especially female, that we have seen. Here we have mentioned the ratio, that the female to male ratio is 4:1. This is the general comparison between acute and chronic. Lesions are present in both. Angioedema can be associated in either of two. The incidence is more common with the acute. It is less common with the chronic. 6 weeks, it is acute. More than six, it is chronic. Etiology, we can generally find out cause in case of acute. Generally chronic, they are idiopathic in nature. Ig mediated allergy, it is common in acute, it is not common in chronic. When there is a chronic urticaria, there are chances that it is associated with some kind of systemic illness. Then the potential for anaphylaxis, that the patient can go into anaphylaxis, chances are more in acute. Chronic, they don't generally go into anaphylactic shock. Then autoantibodies, they are positive or they are found in chronic, whereas in acute we may not be able to detect any autoantibodies. Here comes the pathophysiology. So pathophysiology, the major effector cell in urticaria is a mast cell. So what generally happens is, whenever there is any trigger or any antigen, that antigen gets binds to IgE on the mast cell surface, and these IgE binding on the mast cell surface causes degranulation of the mast cells, and that results into release of histamine. And then this histamine binds to H1 and H2 receptors, and that leads to arterial dilatation, venous constriction, and ultimately this arterial dilatation and venous constriction leads to increased capillary permeability. And due to this capillary permeability, here we can see there is a trigger gets that allergen will cause the formation of IgE. This IgE will get bind to the mast cells, that will cause the degranulation of the mast cells. This degranulation of the mast cell will cause the release of the histamine. Then this histamine will cause vasoconstrictions, and arterial dilatation, and ultimately what will happen, there will be increased permeability, and these increased permeability will lead to transient leakage of the fluid in the surrounding tissues, and there will be a development of veal. So it is like vasodilation will lead to erythema, vasopermeability will lead to plasma leakage. This plasma leakage will cause the transient fluid collection into the surrounding tissue, and that will lead to the formation of the veal. Then again histamine will stimulate the nerve endings, and this stimulation of the nerve ending will result into pruritus. Then this pruritus will cause neuropeptide release, and there will be a flare or the skin response. That is the brief pathology of urticaria. Then one more type of urticaria is there, which is non-immunologic. So in previous one we have seen that first there is like formation of the IgE antibodies, but in this type of non-immunological urticaria there are no IgE receptors. It is not dependent on the IgE receptors, and the example of this non-immunological urticaria is aspirin-induced urticaria. So what happens in such type of urticarias, we have given an example that aspirin may induce histamine release through a pharmacologic mechanism where its effects on arachidonic acid metabolism and causes a release of histamine from mast cells. So there is no role of IgE in it, but still it causes release of histamine, and therefore as there is no role of IgE, it is termed as non-immunologic urticaria. Then we'll come to the sign and symptoms. So as we all know, urticaria is characterized by transient, itchy, elevated edematous veals or the red papules. These lesions are typically edematous, pink or red in color. They are of variable size and shape with surrounding erythema, and they are generally pruritic. A painful or a burning dysthesia suggests the presence of cutaneous vasculitis. What we called in Ayurveda as a tod, that tod is dysthesia, and that is due to cutaneous vasculitis. According to Ayurveda, tod is due to the vata prakopa, and as we know, vata acts on the nerve ending. So here we can correlate that this cutaneous vasculitis will lead to dysthesia or the toad-like symptoms. Then generally these lesions fade up within 24 to 48 hours. Vasculitis lesions may span several days or more and are often followed by residual hyperpigmented changes. So it's like if there is significant vasculitis, then there is residual hyperpigmented changes. But if there is no vasculitis, then generally after the acute episode of the attack is subsided, there is no residual skin changes in urticaria. But if there happens to, if it happens to develop vasculitis at that point of time, then there can be residual hyperpigmented changes. Then other symptoms of the urticaria includes itching, and we can see the lesions in batches, and these batches can be present on face, arm, legs and shoulder. There is burning sensation, that is daha, tightening of chest, difficulty in breathing. These are the symptoms when patients develop some anaphylactic like symptoms, or it is aggravated urticaria and there is laryngeal spasm, or there is inflammation in the pharynx and larynx. Then this will lead to this difficulty in breathing, tightness in chest, and sometimes there can be a throat or the tongue swelling. And here are some of the triggers which can cause the aggravated symptoms in chronic hives: use of latex, even post blood transfusion, exposure to pollen, then exposure to cold, heat or excessive sun, use of antibiotics, nuts, eggs and peanuts, insects bite. These are few of the triggers for the chronic hives. As I've told earlier, urticaria is often present along with the angioedema. So usually urticaria and angioedema, they coexist or they overlap. अर्टिकेरिया अकर मोर कॉमनली एंड इट इज लेस सीवियर देन एंजियोडीमा, बट स्टिल द को एग्जिस्टेंस और द ओवरलैप ऑफ इट इज अ क्वाइट कॉमन सिचुएशन. सो वॉट इज द डिफरेंस बिटवीन अर्टिकेरिया एंड एंजियोडीमा? दो इट अफेक्ट्स द स्किन, मीन्स दो बोथ अफेक्ट द स्किन, अर्टिकेरिया यूजली अफेक्ट्स द स्किन लेयर्स, whereas angioedema affects the tissue beneath the skin, and that is called a subcutaneous tissue or subcutaneous layer. So angioedema, it is a pronounced swelling of the lower dermis or the subcutis. It is most often found in lips, eyelids and genitalia, itching, and sometimes it causes pain. Resolution, it is generally a self-limiting condition. Resolution can take place within 72 hours, and it is associated with urticaria in about 40% of cases. So coexistence or overlapping is a common scenario, and most often we can see the swelling on the lips in case of angioedema. Then this is one more common type of physical urticaria, which is called as dermatographism. There are sharp localized edema or veal within seconds to minutes after the skin has been rubbed, and it affects 2 to 5% of the population, and this is a benign condition. Actually, it doesn't need any treatment as such, but it just make the patients anxious, so we have to counsel them regarding this. As this is a benign condition, it doesn't need as such any interventions or any medications. Now coming to the progression of the disease, how the disease will progress or what will be the course of the disease. So the course of the disease depends on its cause. If it is allergic, then it will continue until the allergen is removed, or it is tolerated by the body, or it get metabolized by the body. Most such patients clear up within a day or two, and even if the allergen is not identified, it may recur if the allergen is met again. And only half of the patients attending the hospital clinics with chronic urticaria, it can last up to 5 years. So it's like the course generally.
Yeah. Yeah. Hello.
Jaspreet Kaur, please mute your mic. Okay, ma'am, you can continue.
Yes, okay. So that is the course of the disease. Then what are the sequelae or the complications? Generally, each is interfering, means each can interfere with the sleep or the daily activities, and that can lead to some anxiety or depression kind of things. In acute anaphylactic reactions, edema of the larynx may lead to asphyxia, and edema of the tracheobronchial tree can lead to asthmatic conditions. So that is something which is a serious complications. Otherwise, generally itching is only a irritating symptoms in case of urticaria, and it can lead to disturbance or the interference with the sleep or the daily activities. Now coming to the differential diagnosis. So first, what we have to differentiate urticaria from, first we have to differentiate the urticarial rash from the other skin conditions or the other skin eruption, and second, then we have to define the type of urticaria. So the first differential diagnosis is to differentiate the eruption of the urticaria from other non-urticarial eruptions, and second, we have to identify or we have to define the which type of urticaria it is. So first we will see what are the eruptions which looks like urticaria or which are similar to urticaria. So first comes the insect bite. So insect bite, generally we can differentiate the rash of insect bite by a presence of central punctum. Generally, whenever there is a sting or insect bite, we can see a central punctum, and that is a differentiating feature which we can with which we can easily differentiate an insect bite from a urticarial rash. Then second is erythema multiforme. So erythema multiforme, generally it is also one of the condition which looks like urticaria. मनसिका है, हाँ, दिस इज एरिथेमा मल्टीफॉर्मे. सो इट इज अ इम्यून रिएक्शन दैट एन इन्फेक्शन और मेडिकेशन कैन ट्रिगर, एंड द मेन सिम्टम विच इज अ रैश ऑन अ बॉडी, इट रिसेम्बल्स लाइक अ बुलसाई. सो दैट इज अ डिफरेंशिएटिंग फीचर ऑफ एरिथेमा मल्टीफॉर्मे फ्रॉम द अर्टिकेरिया. सो वी कैन सी द रैश, बट ईच रैश और ईच मार्क resembles a bullseye, so that is a differentiating feature. Then the second differential diagnosis is urticarial vasculitis. So urticarial vasculitis is a variant of cutaneous small vessel vasculitis. It is characterized by inflamed reddened patches or veils on the skin, and that appears or resembles like urticaria. But when the skin is examined closely under a microscope, we can see the vasculitis, and that way we can differentiate vasculitis from a plain urticaria. Then the third condition which mimics like urticaria are the various bullous diseases. So what are bullae? Bullae are the large blisters of the skin that are filled with clear fluid. So in this type of rashes, the pemphigus are the more common manifestations which we come across. So we have to differentiate between the urticarial rash from the bullous rashes. They can be caused by the infection or inflammation of the skin. Then one more differential diagnosis is erysipelas. So erysipelas is relatively common after bacterial infection of the superficial layer of the skin, and generally it extends to the superficial lymphatic vessels within the skin, and it is characterized by the well-defined tender bright red rash, and typically they are present on the face or legs, and which can occur, means they typically present on face or legs, but they can occur anywhere on the body. Erysipelas can be differentiated from urticaria by their elevated margins or the raised edges. That way we can differentiate. So finally, to conclude, the diagnosis of an urticaria, it is a clinical diagnosis. So we have to first get a detailed history, and then physical examination has to be performed. Many a times it happens that when patient comes to us, there is no rash, so we can ask the patient to take a photograph and show us the picture. And it's like in acute cases we can identify the external cause or external stimuli, but in case of chronic it is difficult to find out the trigger or the external factor which is causing urticaria. If it is physical urticaria, then we can go forward with the challenge test, and we can confirm the triggering factors. Then if it is related to food allergies, then we can consider about IgE. So we have to take a detailed food diary or dietary modification or the use of additives by the patient which has aggravated the symptoms or which cause fluctuations in the symptoms in case of chronic urticaria. So in short, a detailed history taking or any minute changes in the dietary habits we have to look for when we are trying to find out the reasons. Then we have to ask the history of any medications, any antibiotics, use of aspirins. Sometimes NSAIDs also can exacerbate the urticaria. So we have to typically ask for this particular history of use of antibiotics, use of aspirin, use of NSAIDs. And one thing I would like to highlight over here is ki we many a times patients ask us about the detergent use, but generally detergent can cause contact dermatitis. They don't generally cause urticaria. So the change in detergent use is unlikely to be a cause for the development of urticarial rash. Then the investigations generally. Laboratory investigation do not help much in the diagnosis, but detailed history taking is only important. We can go for the physical test, we can go for the allergy test, but to be very frank, investigations doesn't play a major role in diagnosis of the urticaria or for even prognosis purpose, but still we can think about ESR, we can go for IgE levels, and we can go for absolute eosinophil count in case of urticaria. So ESR will help us whether it is a urticarial vasculitis. Eosinophil will help us to rule out the parasitic disease, and that way, and even IgE again will help us to give us a little diagnosis about IgE related urticaria. So ESR, IgE and absolute eosinophil count, these are the few basic investigations which we can go forward with. Then prick test, generally they are unhelpful, and even allergy test, they are unuseful, because patients, when we go for any allergy test, we get a huge 3-4 pages reports, and it's very difficult to it is very difficult to make use of that report and guide accordingly and get the results. So generally laboratory tests are of no use in case of urticaria. Allergy testing is not routinely performed. If the patient is not getting results with any treatment, and if it is disturbing, then we can go for allergy testing. But this just adds additional cost and may not change the line of treatment. So allergy testing is also of no worth in case of a diagnosis. So here it is a simple algorithm. If urticaria, it is lesion lasting for more than 24 hours, and if there are systemic features like arthralgia, then we can consider testing the skin biopsy. If it is non-vasculitis, then it is delayed pressure urticaria, and if we do the skin biopsy and it is showing vasculitis, then it is urticarial vasculitis. If it is associated with autoimmune disorder, then it is autoimmune urticaria. If there is triggers like latex or some animal hairs or some kind of food allergy, then we can go for the appropriate skin test and we can confirm the allergic urticaria. When we are finding any drug use in cases, then we can consider of the trial of drug, and then we can label it as a drug induced. And if there is exclusion of all known precipitating factors and appropriate tests are negative, then we can label it as a idiopathic urticaria. Now the treatment, ideal treatment for the urticaria is to eliminate the trigger or eliminate the cause. In addition, we should avoid aspirin-like drugs in any form. Then the antihistaminics remains the mainstay of symptomatic treatment. So it is like we can go for cetirizine 10 mg per day, loratadine 10 mg per day. They both have half-life time of about 12 hours. So one single dose at bedtime is usually useful. If necessary, this can be supplemented with shorter acting antihistaminics like hydroxyne, which we get with a trade name as Atarax, and it comes in two strengths, 10 milligram and 25 milligram. It is a short acting, and it has got active means it has got its half life of 6 hours. So we can go for either a long acting or short acting antihistaminics. Then also we have longer antihistaminic like chlorpheniramine maleate, where we use 20 milligram sustained release tablets every 12 hours. Chlorpheniramine and diphenhydramine are often used during pregnancy because their long record of safety, but cetirizine, loratadine and mesolastin should be avoided. We can see even in pregnancy, in the last terms of the pregnancy, patients suffer from the itching like of symptoms. So that time the drug of choice is either diphenhydramine or even terbutaline is used during that period. So when it comes to antihistaminics, to give you a little brief about antihistaminics are of two types, H1 antihistaminics and H2. So H1 antagonists are the class of medications that block the action of histamine at the H1 receptors, and they are usually help to relieve the allergic reactions. Then H1 also, they are subcategorized into first generation, second generation, and third generation. So first generation, they are again ethyldimines, ethylamines, alkylamines, piperazine, and tricyclines. So ethylenediamines, what we get in ethylenediamines is antazolin. Then ethanolamines, we get bromazine and diphenhydramine. Then alkylamines, we get chlorpheniramine maleate and tripolidine. Then piperazine group, we get hydroxine and meclizine. And tricyclites, we get ciproheptadine and promethazine. Then second generation H1, they are estimizole, cetrizine, loratidine, and terfenadine. And third generation is levocetrizine, pixofenadine, and desloratidine. These are the H1 blockers. And what are H2 blockers? H2 blockers are used generally like whatever we use, ranitidine, cimetidine, famotidine, they are the H2 blockers. Generally, H2 blocker antihistaminics, they are used along with the H1 blockers. They have got synergistic effects. When we add H2 blockers to H1, the result is rapid and there is complete resolution of the urticaria. H2 alone, they are that way not very useful, but along with H1, when they are used, they found to be more, there we can find out the rapid onset of the action and even a complete resolution. Therefore, H1 and H2 antihistaminics are preferred. Then sympathomimetic drugs also we can use for urticaria, and the drug which is best used is pseudoephedrine. It is given 30 to 60 milligram every 4 hours. Even terbutaline, as I've said, it can be given 2.5 milligram every 8 hours. Then a systemic corticosteroids, when H1 and H2 blockers are not giving good results, then short-term tapering dose of systemic corticosteroids can be used. Then if that also fails, then we have to go for low-dose cyclosporine. So when it comes to the chronic urticaria, we can broadly go ahead with step 1, step 2, step 3, step 4. Step 1 is to avoid trigger, then monotherapy with second generation antihistaminic. Second generation antihistaminics are cetrizine, loratidine, and terbinadine, and estimizole. Then step 2 is dose advancement of second generation. Then we can add another second generation, we can add H2 antagonist, then we can add leukotriene receptors, and again we can add first generation at bedtime. Then the step 3 is dose advancement of potent antihistaminic, and step 4 is anti-inflammatory agent or immunosuppressants. Antileukotrienes is montelukast, which we commonly use. Means there has been various studies for the use of these antileukotrienes in case of urticaria. There are controlled trials which has been conducted for this montelukast group, and we could find out that 5 of the RCTs, they could find the favorable results, and one of the trial there was no advantage with these leukotrienes. So these are the drugs which we can use when there is refractory urticaria, means after giving H1 and H2, again there is relapse, then it is called as refractory urticaria, and if it is associated with angioedema. So these are the drugs, colchicine, sulfasalazine, this we can try for the refractory urticaria. So to summarize, antihistaminic remains the mainstay of the therapy. Generally, in refractory cases, they are ineffective. Then we can go for corticosteroids. मीन्स वॉट वी कैन कंक्लूड विद दिस स्लाइड इज कि एंटी हिस्टामिनिक्स कॉर्टिकोस्टीरॉइड्स दीज आर दी ओनली ड्रग ऑफ चॉइसेस और दी treatment line available according to the modern sciences in case of management of urticaria. Now we will move ahead to the Ayurvedic perspective of urticaria. So as we all know, in Ayurveda, the allergic manifestations, they are mentioned under the concept of satmya and asatmya. So it manifests due to exposure of asatmya ahar vihar and contact with different poisonous material, which we called as allergens. In Ayurvedic classics, the term shita pitta, udarda and kot, these are the three disorders which are described or which are almost similar, but they have got few differentiating characters. Like shita pitta is of vata predominance, udarda is of kapha predominance, and kotha is due to some definite etiopathogenesis, and there is a pittadhikya in case of kotha. Now when we see the classical context, the symptoms of allergic skin reaction is mentioned as kotha in Brihatrayi. Later on it is developed as a separate disease under the title shita pitta udarda and koth by Madhav Nidana. Madhavkar has mentioned the shita pitta and udarda as synonyms. He quoted that shita pitta having vatic dominancy while udarda have kapha's predominance, and the Madhavkar also has mentioned the specific characters for the udarda. Then Acharya Charak Sanhita has not directly used a word shita pitta, but in various contexts there has been use of words like koth, utkot and udarda. Now comes to the nidan of shita pitta. Exposure to cold wind leads to visitation of a kapha and vata dosha. It combines with pitta and that results into impurities in the blood, and these impurities in blood leads to various skin manifestations. Then comes the ahara jhetu, santarpan, atilavan sevan, ati amla sevan, katu sevan, kshara sevan, tikshna madhya sevan, viruddha ahar, अध्यशन, गुरु द्रव्य, स्निग्ध भोजन, दधि सेवन, विषयुक्त अन्न सेवन, दीज आर दी आहारज निदान और आहारज हेतु इन केस ऑफ शीत पित्त. विहारज हेतु इंक्लूड्स शीत, मारुत स्पर्श, विषयुक्त जल स्नान, अभ्यंग, उद्वर्तन, वस्त्र आभूषण, कीटक दंश, बाह्य कृमि, छर्दी निग्रह, दैट इज वेग विधारण, अति दिवास्वाप, शिशि ऋतु, वर्षा क्वाल एंड दिवास्वाप. देन निदानार्थक रोग ऑफ फॉर अर्टिकेरिया दे आर टर्म मीन्स इट द निदानार्थक रोग इंक्लूड सन्निपातिक ज्वर, पित्तज एंड कफ ज्वर, उन्माद, अधोगमल पित्त, दे आर टर्म्ड एज अ निदानार्थक रोग फॉर अर्टिकेरिया. देन चिकित्सा मिथ्या योग includes Vaman Virechan Ayog, that is Panchakarma Ayog also can lead to urticaria. Then when we see the symptomatology according to Ayurveda, the specific term has been used for the urticarial rash, and it is termed as a Varti Dausha Samstana Shotha, means inflammation like an insect bite, Kandu Bahula, Todh Bahula. And patient may also get chardi, jwar, vidah, soto sanga mandal, and shanik utpatti, shanik vinash. That is transient rash here we have to consider with this symptom. Then comes the samprapti. Samprapti shloka in Ayurveda is like shita maruta samsparshat, pradushto kapha maruto, pittena saha sambhuya, bahiranta visarpataha. That means prakupit vata and kapha due to shita marutadi nidana, when being mixed with the pitta dosha, it spreads internally and externally and results into shita pitta udarda and koth. Exposure to cold or suppression of natural urges causes the vitiation of kapha and vata dosha. Pitta prakop is due to lifestyle causes, and this pitta vitiation will further lead to more vitiation of vata dosha and resulting into the shita pitta. when we consider the samprapti ghatakas for urticaria, dosh is, it is tridosh janyavadi, there is agni mandya, there is vruddhi, and tiryak gati or the shakha gati. When we consider the dosha gati, vyadhi marga, we can consider it as a bahya roga marga vidhi, a vyadhi. Dusha is rasa and rakta. Srotas, rasava srotas and raktava srotas are the srotas are involved in case of urticaria or shita pitta. Soto dushti, it is vimarga gaman soto dushti. Then udbhavstan, it is amashay because it is due to mandagni. Then vyaktistan is twacha, and swabhav, it is ashukari vyadhi. This is the samprapti ghatakas. Then when we come to the chikisa, so Chakradatta has elaborately described the shaman chikisa for the shita pitta, and the Chakradatta has given the considerable importance to the dosha gati. He has advised that the individuals who are suffering from shita pitta can be given either sheet or ushnahar and paniya dravya, which with due consideration of dosha gati. So he has given importance to dosha gati. Bhav Prakasha has described Shodhan Chikisa, Shaman Chikisa, and Bahiparimarjan Chikisa for Shita Pitta. Yog Ratnakar has described Krimigna and Dadrugna Dravyas he has asked us to use in Shita Pitta. Bhaisyaja Ratnavali has mentioned that patients suffering from Kotha should in brief adopt the line of treatment prescribed for Kushta Vyadi, Amla Pitta, and Udarda. So, to sum up all this acharya, what they have to say, we can consider the treatment principle as follows. We can go for snehan, we can go for swedan, vaman, virechan, raktamokshan, lep, and udvartan. These are the treatment principles. Then what we can consider while treating the urticaria, first we have to think about the agnivardhan. Then we have to also think in terms of rakta prasadan, anta parimarjan, kapha vatahar and vatanuloman, daha prashavan. So when it comes to agni vardhan, these are the drugs which we should consider, suta shekhar ras and lagu sut shekhar ras. When we are considering rakta prasadan, we can use sariva ghanavati, rajanyadi churna and ushirasa. When it comes to anta parimarjan, we have to use haridra khanda or arogya vardhini vati. As you all know, haridra is known kandugna and it is rakta shodak dravya. It is a blood purifier, good blood purifier. Arogya vardhini, it is deepan, pachan, shoto vishodhan. So for anta parimarjan, we should consider these two drugs. For kapha vatagna and vatanuloman, samir pannag is a drug of choice. Then when there is excessive daha, then for daha prashaman, we can consider kamdudaras, mauktik yukta kamduda, or we can go for plain mauktik bhasma. Even gairik is drug of choice when there is daha. We can use it as a local application with the gogrut, or we can also use it with cold water. Then rakta shodhan, we can consider sariva, manjishta, guduchi, nimba and dhamasa. For kandu prashaman, when there is excessive itching, we should consider vanga bhasma and trivanga bhasma. For bahir parimarjan, we can consider various lepas and various applications. So yavakshar plus sendav, and that is mixed with teal tail. Then sarshap tail abhyanga is one of the very beneficial remedy in case of urticaria. Ushnodak snan. Then sushutokta eladi gun is also one of the useful gun in management of urticaria. So eladi gun or aragvadadi churna lep is also one of the bahiparimarjan treatment in case of urticaria. Then when it comes to apunarbhav chikisa, amruta rajanyadi yog, chaturbhuj ras, guduchadi loha with dhanya kwat, these are the apunarbhav chikisa which are mentioned in classics. Then to give a brief about the various shodhan chikisa, they have this in Ayurvedic classics, when they have asked us to do Vaman in case of urticaria, there has been mention of specific dravyas to conduct this Vaman. So emesis in case of urticaria should be given with the decoction of patol or nimba patra along with madan phal. When it comes to virechan, then for purgation we can use trifaya kwath with gugul and pimpli churna, or we can go for trifaya kwath plus madhu, or we can go for navakarshik kashaya. Navakarshik kashaya is also one of the drug which is mentioned in vata rakta rogadikar, and in typically in urticaria they have mentioned the use of this navakarshik kashaya. Then